Good evening, members of the audience and everyone viewing online, wherever you may be, and welcome to our Brass Spectacular. We're currently in what we call week 13, or our second week of revisions for exams. And so I had to explain to the students as to why we're still going when we started on the 13th of January, and even in our reading week, our spring vacation, many of the students behind me were in Ireland with the chamber orchestra, so we literally haven't stopped the whole year. But brass players love to play with other brass players, and many of the students behind me are simply superb, and some of them are leaving the university. Indeed, Matthew, one of the trumpet players, is leaving tomorrow, but a number of others have. This is their last concert in St. Andrews, and I wanted them to end their time here among friends, among their best friends, other people who play brass. This is probably the most ambitious concert we've done in quite a number of years, mainly because of the last piece of the program, the Gunther Schuller Brass Symphony. And I'm thrilled, if not a little bit relieved, to have John and some players from the Wallace Collection to help us along the way. We started with the Strauss Vienna Philharmonic Fanfare, written in 1924 as a fundraiser for the orchestra's pension scheme. It's one of his four works for large brass ensemble. To introduce the next piece, I have John Miller just to behind me. Here is John.
Thank you, Bede. Now, to continue with our next piece is going to be Sonata Octavi Toni in 12 parts by Giovanni Gabrieli. Now, this piece was published as a part of a collection. It was published in 1597. Gabrieli wrote his music for St. Mark's Venice with its fantastic acoustic, a little bit like here, a room with a fantastic acoustic. There are two choirs that are quite closely sort of connected one to another. Now, this music, it really went out of fashion after it was performed, and it was written at a time when these modern instruments with valves were not invented. So we are playing a transcription for modern instruments. Now, the music of Giovanni Gabrieli was largely unheard until more modern times. Now, the first performance that I know of on modern brass of Gabrieli was 1878 in Leipzig. Now, this was followed in the 20th century. The music of Gabrieli, particularly his very famous sonata pianoforte, to which this has similarities, that was played in the 1930s by Bolt and the members of the BBC Symphony Orchestra in very prominent concerts in the Queen's Hall in London, broadcast and so on. But as brass players, I think we like to think of the music of Gabrieli as very much our own.
Thank you. Hi everyone. This next piece is Interstellar Call, which is a work for solo horn, initially written as part of a larger work by the composer Olivier Messiaen called From the Canyons to the Stars. It was initially written to commemorate the bicentenary of the signing of the US Declaration of Independence in 1976.
Thank you. Benjamin Britten's.
Is it?
Benjamin Britten's Russian funeral music is one of the earliest works for orchestral symphonic brass ensemble dating from 1936. Benjamin Britten at 23 was already a prodigiously prolific composer and a confirmed pacifist, and he wrote this piece as a protest against the rise of fascism in Europe at the start of the Spanish Civil War. And it was first performed at London's Labour Choral Union, conducted by Alan Bush. The composer, who later taught many composers at the Royal Academy of Music, among them Scots such as Bill Sweeney, Eddie Maguire, and myself. This piece then dropped from view until rediscovered by Philip Jones and performed again by his famous brass ensemble around 1980. John Miller and I played in that performance, and it's so long ago that we think it's earlier than 1980, but our memories, like all memories of old men, get quite hazy. And then its main theme, a Russian funeral hymn, was later used by Britten's friend Shostakovich in his 11th symphony.
Thank you. So, the piece I'm about to play for you is called Basta. It was commissioned in 1982 to develop the solo trombone repertoire. It's commissioned by the Stockholm School of Music for Christian Lindberg by Folk Robber, and it does feature quite a lot of, like the horn piece you just heard, a lot of the very unusual extended techniques for the instrument. So I hope you enjoy Basta.
Thank you.
John mentioned the Britten, very significant and early piece for symphonic brass ensemble from the 30s. Just a few weeks ago, Aaron Copland's Fanfare for the Common Man from the 40s was performed by the Music Society Symphony Orchestra here in St. Andrews. That was a commission from the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra. In the 1950s, another very significant piece for orchestral brass, for symphonic brass, by Ratavara, a Finnish composer, kind of basically commissioned by the Cincinnati Symphony Orchestra, or a competition that they ran, was performed by the Chamber Orchestra in early 2022. So we're kind of completing a little bit of a set of the big 20th century brass pieces being performed here in St. Andrews, but this is a missing link, and I'm delighted that we have a little bit of a living history between John and the group, Tuschula, which John will tell you about now.
Try not to knock the stand over. Well, Bede talked about the Copland Fanfare for the Common Man. Well, that later became a major part of his Third Symphony, but sitting in the orchestra in Cincinnati when that was first done was 18-year-old Gunther Schuller. And Gunther Schuller really learned everything he knew about music through absorbing other people's music, through playing it, really. And you know, he played in his lifetime with Miles Davis and Dizzy Gillespie and absorbed all that into a new way of composing called third stream, which was between jazz and classical music. But during the rehearsals yesterday, I had one of these eureka moments when we were rehearsing the second movement of Schuller's symphony, and I said, my goodness, that just sounds like Benjamin Britten's 4C interludes. And sure enough, I went up and used Professor Google and found that Gunther Schuller had actually been in the Metropolitan Orchestra in New York from 1945 to 1959 as principal horn. And what did they perform in 1948 but the American premiere of Peter Grimes? So listen carefully to the second movement for fingerprints of Benjamin Britten, especially you'll hear the thirds going up in the trombones. Da-da-da-da. It doesn't actually go da-da-da-da-da, but you'll hear echoes of Britten in that movement. I got to know Gunther Schuller a little bit whilst doing his trumpet concerto with him in Maida Vale with the BBC Symphony Orchestra in a recording, and we, you know, spent some time together. And he was a considerable music educationalist as well, and he actually attributed himself with discovering Wynton Marsalis as well, who he used to run a Tanglewood summer school. And this little kid came along, I think 17 at the time, to play him the last movement of the Bach's Brandenburg Concerto, which is quite difficult on the trumpet. And he said, and this kid just came in and said, you know, don't let me down, baby, to his trumpet, and then just played it. And so, and then Wynton Marsalis became famous, just like Gunther Schuller, for his prowess in classical as well as jazz. But this is a brilliant work. It's very rarely performed, and it's just fantastic that we're doing it with the pride of St. Andrews tonight, and just incredible what's happened in the last few years to the standards, musical standards amongst the students, especially, of course, the brass players. So thank you, Bede.
In four movements.
Thank you. Thank you.